And welcome back to another episode of Let's Play Pillars of Eternity Blind. I'm the RPG Chick. I just sold all my crap. And now we have 3,623. And we got our full camping supplies, so even after all that, so what we can do now is get a room.
Hello.
Which I don't think we've done before. So we've got the common room, which is, wow, doesn't cost anything. I think that's as a thank you, because we helped, what's his name, the cook. Laborer's rest is +1 perception and +1 mechanics, and Deerwood's pride is +2 resolve. We're going to go with Deerwood's pride, since we have over 3,000, whatever, gold, copper. 113 copper, yes. Oh, nice. This animation. Ah, well rested. We gotta go visit the blacksmith. And I have a score to settle with a certain Skulder King. So, yeah, I'm going to tie up some loose ends
in this
episode. Black Hammer Smithy.
Good day, stranger.
Welcome, my good man. Hand over the crate. I found that shipment you were waiting on. To a tanner reaches out to take the crate, raising it effortlessly onto the counter. His face splits into a broad smile. I had trouble with that sentence. Why, so you have. This is excellent news. We can finally get back to work and show you real Blackhammer quality. None of those flimsy little swords. Here, I'll give you a taste. He ducks behind the counter and rises with a heavy wooden shield in hand. Might not have had much in the way with materials to work with, but it's still Black Hammer craftsmanship. You go on and take that. And here, some coin for your troubles, too. His pleased expression dims. Did you find anyone with the wagon? Bandits overtook the wagon. I doubt your people survived. Tortanu shakes his head. Running a hand over his bald pate. Poor fools. I always told them they ought to hire some guards instead of palming the extra coin. I'll have to hire on more hands. Don't suppose you want to settle in Gilded Vale, try some delivery work? He smiles thinly. You have my thanks for your assistance, friend. Give me some time to work the forge, and you'll have your pick of the next run of weapons. Okay, so he gave us 100 copper, and he gave us an item. Larder door. Properties bashing 2. Huh, it used to be a door? This shield appears to have once quite literally comprised the front of a larder. It still has the pull ring and metal crossbands reinforcing its surface, giving it considerable heft when swung at an opponent. Despite its humble origins, the nicks and gouges on the shield's surface suggest it has seen more than a few battles in its time, and proves a sturdy defense, though it leaves the harrowing prospect that there may be a larder somewhere lying undefended. Oh, we really sacrifice in accuracy here. I'm just gonna have him hold on to it for now. I really don't want him missing all the time.
Well met, friend.
We've made good use of those supplies you brought us. Some of my best work. You ever want to see our special stock, you just say the word. Yeah, I'd like to see your wares, please. So now we got these fine weapons. Ooh. Grants jolting touch. Should I read this? Did we have this before? I don't remember what I read about. The War of Black Trees brought hardship and suffering to many Glamfellens, but it bore special tragedy for its druidic orders, who were forced not only to endure the deaths of many friends and kin, but also the destruction of the lands they revered above all else. Among these was Azerith, a young Ovate. Deeply troubled by the use of the elements to turn nature against the people of Ir Glanfath, and wondering if he was seeing the last days of his people, Azerith took to walking the endless stretches of burned-down forests in search of something, anything, that might signal a reason to hope. He found it in an old ironwood tree, thick and gnarled with roots that ran in waves to the ground as though they had been woven there. It stood as it always had, though, singed well up the side of its trunk now, while everything around it had been incinerated by the soldiers of Deerwood, leaving a wasteland 1,000 acres in every direction. Hold on a second, guys. Azerith plucked a single branch from the old tree. I think I did read this. I'm just gonna forge on ahead anyway. Making sure to express his profound gratitude, an accomplished organic artificer, Azerith reshaped the branch into a blade that would rival any made in a forge. He infused it with the strength of the elements, vowing never again to be at their mercy, and resolving that if the tree could endure, so too could he. In his hands, the blade found its way into the hearts of many soldiers who stood at the edge of forests with torches and barrels of pitch, and by the war's end, he had saved many forests from the flame. When his years were drawing to a close, Azerith made a final pilgrimage back to the old ironwood tree, which still stood. And he laid the knife at its base to be taken up by someone else in need of inspiration in dark times. On his way there, he was pleased to see that beneath the ashes that covered the forest floor, new life had begun to spring. Azerith's stiletto is unusual, as the entire weapon is dark red-brown wood. Even the blade, the magic used in the creation, hardened and protected the wood, preventing it from chipping or warping. Green, dark green vines and leaves sprout from it and wrap themselves around the hilt to form the grip. So I guess the difference is we've got all these fine weapons. I wanted to look at it. Yeah, I don't want it. Too much money. I'm gonna hold off on getting any of this stuff for now. Get a ring of deflection, sure. What does she have? Gaunt's Pledge. I'm gonna save this. If I get more money, I'll come back and buy more rings and stuff like that. But as for now, we're done. What's this? Kolsk. I remember him. I remember that name. Hold, madam, but a moment. A hooded man waits upon the road, clad in a green cloak. He strides forward to meet you as you approach, and at a closer distance his features are revealed for those of a younger man, though lined with weariness. He appears to be favoring his left leg as he walks, and there is a dark stain upon the fabric of his trousers under the knee. Even so, he greets you with a polite bow. I imagine Tutano is very grateful for the return of his supplies. He is a good smith, a good man at that. Beholden to a cruel master, but a good man. Gilded Vale is full of such people, people who deserve better than to watch their home descend into fear and madness. He turns to look out over the village. I aim to save them, and I would ask your help in doing so. Who are you? Only a man determined to see Gilded Vale restore it to its former glory. There was a time, stranger, when Gilded Vale was worthy of its name. The wheat shone like gold on the hills, and the village's people lived well. Eater says, I don't know about the golden crops, but there were less flies anyway. And what has become of it now? Whatever has caused the blight upon our lands, it is not the fault of its people. Radric looks to punish us for crimes we have not committed, and in turn he is blind to his own. I am not, and he will pay for what he has done. I, Kolsk, swear it by the flame. Like many tyrants, he has surrounded himself with stronger men and women for fear of retribution. The man smiles thinly. And so you are warned. If you would press on despite that, however, I wonder we might not help one another. What is it you want me to do? The man nods, standing a little straighter. It is a grim task that I ask of you, but I assure you there is no other option. Lord Radric must be stopped. Too long has Gilded Vale suffered under Radric's madness. He would cure Wydwin's legacy by ensuring there are none alive in the village to be afflicted. I fear his own wife, Ygritte, may be at risk. The man has no mercy in him. We have not stood idle. My people and I breached the defenses, intent on ending Radric's rule ourselves. We entered through the sewers under cover of night, but we were routed. His face darkens. There are dark creatures down there in the dungeons, the work of Radric's animancer. It falls to you. Lord Radric has called for further reinforcements, and soon there will be no stopping him. Our time grows short, and in this hour I must beg assistance where I can. Aelas says, he is going to owe us more than some rubble-strewn plot of land after this. Fling him from the ramparts, or else cut his head from his shoulders. I care not. Once his throne lies empty, Gilded Vale will have the stewardship that it deserves. I don't have the option now to ask for money. I will find Radric and deal with him. Then I commend you on your courage, and thank you for your assistance, but I would not send you onward without due warning. Radric's hold is crawling with soldiers and sellswords, all loyal to Radric. They will not take kindly to intruders. In truth, they will be all the more alert for our failed efforts. A frontal assault would be unwise. If you would brave it, you could follow our steps and seek out the entrance to the sewers at the eastern edge of the moat. He looks away. But several of my men were captured. It may be the entrance has been found and sealed anew. These men were under my command. I would be in your debt if you found some means of helping them. Once you make it inside, seek out my old friend Nedmar. He is the High Priest. Baratheon. Game of Thrones, huh? Baratheon, now that the Shining God has fallen, a good man in difficult circumstances. He will listen to reason. Durrance chortles, nearly choking on his own disdain. Shining God. He never shone so brightly as when the bomb took him. The moniker is absolute now. Ash. Obsolete now. Ash does not shine. Eater says, it's like if someone was to call you the attractive priest, Durrance. Nedmar can help you reach Radric, but he resides in the upper level of Radric's hold, protected by guards and mercenaries. You will have to keep to the shadows if you mean to reach him without alarming the entire keep. Well, I guess we're off to do this now. Thank you for the advice. I will make good use of it. I consider it a blessing from the gods that I have found someone that understands honor and duty. Radric's hold lies past the Esternwood, not far to the east. May Magrin bring you victory, friend. I wish you luck. Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. To the east. What's to the east? How do we get over there? Is it this patch here that we're wondering about? And I'm assuming, you know, north, west, south, east. Well, let's head back in the sewers and kill that thing. Okay, before we go up, apparently Kana wants to talk to you.
Poor Meyerwald. He couldn't contend with all that he knew of himself. A cruel fate.
Yeah, speaking of the events of last episode. I don't think knowledge was the problem. He said that if I can find out what caused this, it might help me. That is true, and there is no such thing in my experience as too much knowledge. Kana smiles. Come, we'll find your answers, and mine, I hope. Anything else? Anyone else have stuff to say?
Following your lead. Yes, my friend?
I'm ready if you are, Kana.
It's good to be on the road again. A wanderlust is nothing rare in the people of Rauatai. But often I think myself alone in loving the land as much as the sea. What shall we see next, I wonder?
You know anything about this place? We are, as they say, off the map. Off my map, at least. I have no idea where we are. Isn't it exciting?
Hmm? If doubts and curiosity plague you, you're skidding your knuckles on the wrong door.
Tell me about Magrin. Oh, you know her. You must. He gives a bitter chuckle, and then his tone evens out. She's a many-headed bitch. Does she have any allies?
Some. Shaped for hunt and war. Abidan the Golem. Galawain and his beasts. The latter keeps us honest and awake. The other makes the tools by which we punish those who are not.
He pauses, his fingers scratching at a pock scar on his cheek. Durance lets his free hand form a double grip on his staff. Abidan? Not surprised you haven't heard. More gods than weeds in a field, and those are only the ones of this lifetime. They come and go, but are always here at the same time. I'm not sure that I'm always here at the same time. Abidan used to look human, Durance grunts. Got killed, then built a new body for himself. Transformation, with Magrin's help. Perhaps she needed her own blacksmith to tend the fires. If so, Abidan deserves it. Durance frowns. He's a weapon, a tool, not a god, in my mind. Still, the people of Deerwood, the cities especially, hold him dear. So be it. Although if the reward for hard work and craftsmanship is a body like his, I'll keep my blood and my cock and hips to thrust it with. Okay. Alrighty then. You also mentioned Galloween. Monster father, the great hound. And as for monsters, this world has quite a bit. And not just the ones on two legs. It's as if he'd made monsters to hunt them, to remind men of their place. He's busy making more, I suspect. More monsters than sense. Variation upon variation. Hmm. What do you mean? His aspects are a confusing bunch, and considering he respects reversals of fortune, especially in beasts, probably not so confusing. No wonder why Magrin and he share a bed, in my eyes, even if he does believe in a trial. A filthy Orland god in many ways, howling and mewling perhaps like they do. They can keep their beasts. I'll take fire and weapons any day. I wanted to ask you something else about Magrin. I fear you may not like the heat of the fire, Watcher, but if you can bear it, then I will tell you what I know. Who are her enemies?
Before, when you asked about allies, well now, ally, enemy, that's a skin's edge of difference in history's eye. But there were enemies. Were.
Got a great voice actor, this one. The mirth leaves his face, and he sneers. Aethas. Durance gives a cold grin, nods. But we sorted that out. Then, Hylea, and her queen's crown of feathers and birds. He sneers. Perhaps she claims to see the world from her perch. I hope she saw what happened to Aethas, and if she dares to walk upon an earth where such fire runs. Her temples are things of windows and twittering music. If a bird falls, know that it's a victory. Seeing another set of darting eyes from that feathered bitch die is a pleasure to me. You bear her a lot of rage. She and her clergy offer shelter to the Aethasian since his death, his humiliation. She's next for me. What is your view on Magrin?
She's a goddess, as fickle as they come. And with all the failings you'd expect of an empress and a whore. Too many eyes, too many wants, too much to hold on to. That's the failing of a god. More aspects than words to describe her, like most of them. A god with many nations to oversee, only serves to spread herself too thin.
Although Flame really crosses twice, so perhaps that is the only truth she embraces. Who knows? Gods get greedy. When it comes to fire, fire is a god's hunger. What are her aspects? Durance begins to count on his fingers, chanting it off. War transforms, fire consumes, trials purify. Warfare, fire, consuming, purification, and most of all, transforming. Trials as well, but all things are put to the test anyway. A trial can consume, purify, transform. They are all linked, although at its heart is the flame, and the flame is what matters. It is the source of all things. Guess they should have started over with that, huh? Any fool around a campfire knows that. Without flames, fire, we would have made little progress in the dark. To hear some of the inner fires tell it around the hearth and bellows, even in the halls of Ashfall, you'd think that fire bright light brought life to man and that fire was Magrin. Some of the older texts say she rubbed her hands together and they burst into flame. Or another god shafted her like a poker. There are different perspectives on her, then? He grunts. Mine is only one sight among many. Durance frowns, pauses. Then his eyes take on an eager gleam. But here's one. I can speak to how the losing side sees her, and that should tell you enough. Let me speak to what a Nadirian sees. What does a Nadirian see? The Edirians have a proper, polite translation for her. Excellence in war. Tactical discipline. He snorts. That's why they lost the fucking colony, of course. They were properly still quoting that while we have them bent across their decks. My apologies for the language here, guys, but I figured you want me to read it all, so... All their guns and cannons are fine, but useless when your staff is crackling light into their skulls, dispensing red gifts left and right. Durance's fists tighten, and he laughs. Edirians call that elevation, divine awareness. Those words are as welcome as shit on one's boots, and that's all they took back with them while they were running. He shakes his head. A lesson learned at the wrong time. Almost feel a pang of sympathy for them. Almost. Lesson? What do you mean? The title of a god isn't knowing a god. adhering to words rather than walking the path, testing yourself in the heat of it. Walk until the words are stripped away, and you feel it burning in your heart. That is the lesson. That Adirian politeness, that pretty adherence to the world of script, the word of scripture as they saw it, that burned their ships, scarred them, kept them running throughout the Deerwood campaign. He snorts. Divine awareness. There's no true faith in waiting to be tested. The best in battle have already shit themselves aplenty. Shit themselves until they're dry and can focus on the killing.
Huh. I suspect the answers will seed more questions.
See if there's anything more it'll tell us about the region and its history that we haven't already seen. I don't want to say yet. Are you a servant of Wheel? Let mysteries and questions remain with him, at least until the next time we need rest. Alright, anything else?
Hey.
Eater scratches his head and smirks. Well, I guess talking to a crazy watcher is better than talking to no watcher at all.
Hmm?
Yes?
Any idea what I should do next? Asking Aelath. He tugs at his sleeves. Meyerwald urged you to seek out these Leaden Key agents in Defiance Bay, yes? If his condition is any warning, we should find them with all haste.
Yeah? Eh?
Well, being it's like coming up on a half hour in, I'm going to call an episode here, and next episode will hopefully see us destroy utterly the Skulder King. Last time we fought him, we were levels 2, 1 and 2. Maybe the main character was 3, I don't even know. But we are higher levels now, and we have friends with us, these three. So thanks for watching, see you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.